little bit better, isn't it? All right, so why don't people get the best out of their meditation and mindfulness practice? So I spent near enough a couple of decades living in Zen training places where really the whole life was focused around doing everything that was really humanly possible to sort of optimize meditation and mindfulness practice work. So I certainly got to see some potentials. Now, I came back from Japan in 2007, but I had a little problem. So what would you do if you came back to the UK essentially penniless, with no invitations or anything, and not really sure what you were going to do with in terms of sharing it? So it was a question. So what I did I went to the south tip of the Isle of Wight in my monk's robes with my bowl, and I started walking northwards. And the plan, such as it was to basically do my best to walk up the center line of the island of Britain, just living on food that people sort of donated along the way. And so I started at dawn on midsummer morning, 2007, and about five-ish, a little bit before. And around about 9:30, I was walking across the Isle of Wight, and a car kind of pulled up next to me. The window went down. This lady said, "Are you Daizan?" And I said, "Yeah." And she said, "I heard about you on Isle of Wight Radio. Will you teach me to meditate?" And I said, "All right." So she kind of pulled the car in, nearly ran over my foot, and got out. And we sat on the grass verge there, and she sat on my rucksack on the verge, and we did some practice together. And over the last 11 years, I've been basically been hanging about on a bunch of metaphorical grass verges, really, practicing with people. In 2009, we established a meditation and mindfulness teacher training program. We've got about 230 teachers now in the UK, in Japan, America, Europe. So we've now got quite a bunch of us. And essentially, we're all doing, got the same sort of intention, really. We're all focused around helping people try to make a success of their meditation and mindfulness work. So I thought it might be useful or might be worthwhile to share some of the surprising and maybe not so surprising things that we found that really seem to make a difference. So I've basically sort of grouped them into what I've been calling the Big Five. Numero uno. We found that new meditators can have wildly varying and sometimes very unrealistic expectations about how it's going to unfold. And then the actual experience of confronting the inner mental chaos, the seemingly endless distraction, the creativity of the monkey mind pulling left and right, can be very sort of disheartening. Very often, we find it almost normal that people tend to feel worse before they feel better when they're doing this. And I think it's really important that those of us who love this work are really careful that we don't oversell it. It's not a panacea, as we know. There are no panaceas. And as I'm sure all of us probably know, or the vast majority of us, the results really take a while to manifest. Very often, others notice them before the person themselves. So, it's a sad thing sometimes happens where people give up when actually it's working beautifully, but they just haven't yet got the perspective on the unfolding process. So I think it's really, really important, particularly when we're guiding others, to help them form realistic expectations and also realistic timescales. We've found the most sort of useful orientation is really to try to have people focus on the journey rather than projected destinations. If people can find satisfaction in the day-by-day process, then that seems to kind of give them the best basis. Now, we've found that people who sort of jump in with both feet and commit themselves to kind of extensive or extreme kind of practice regimes tend to fizzle out on it, to burn out on it. I constantly tell students that this stuff should improve your life, not take over your life. So, you know, I tend to emphasize that what we're dealing with is a marathon rather than a sprint. Now, for it to work well, for that marathon to be run, it needs to become a habit. So a lot of what myself and our teachers have been working with over the last decade or so is how to help people essentially form a meditation habit. Now, I'm a big fan of a wonderful researcher who's just down the road here at UCL called Dr. Philippa Lally. Now, she probably knows more than anybody else in the world around the area of health and habits. She started off working in the weight loss field and has kind of expanded from there. So her definition of a habit is actions that are triggered automatically in response to contextual cues that have been associated with their performance. Okay, so you have a cue and an action. You know, as we know, the cue might be getting in the car, the habitual action, reaching for the seatbelt. So what forges that link? What forges that association? The key thing, repetition. Now, the actual process of building a habit, she's kind of isolated it into stages. So the tough bit, the initial bit that requires the kind of the willpower and the grit and the commitment is what they call the initiation phase, where you're essentially, you're working against the grain of your previous kind of life experience and life engagement. And then you have what they call the learning phase, where what develops is what they call automaticity, where the habit starts to build an energy, if you like, a momentum. And then you've got a full-blown habit in what they call the stability phase. And this is the point where it feels more strange to not do something than to do it. Okay, that's when they consider a habit is stable. Now, you've probably heard this kind of chestnut that it takes 21 days to form a habit. You heard that one? It's kind of quite widely sort of broadcast. Well, Philippa has completely exploded that one. It's just not the case. Instead, she's found that automaticity, this kind of, you know, this habit energy when it starts to run itself, can take up to 254 days to build. It varies from person to person. An average is around about 66 days, she found. Okay, so it takes really a while before things really get into a groove. So those of us who are running like an 8-week meditation and mindfulness process, which seems to have become quite widespread, we may actually be dropping our students in it just a little bit early, you know, for optimal kind of ongoing practice experience for them. She's also found that failure is counterproductive. You know, it builds the opposite habit. So it's really important that the habits are built in kind of easy stages. We found the level that seems to work practically is about 25 minutes meditation practice a day. That seems to be an amount that most people find challenging but doable and buildable on. some of our teachers have been working with, starting with even shorter periods and gradually ramping up. That also seems to be quite successful. Now, Philip has found that missing the occasional day in building a habit is fine. Actually, it doesn't necessarily derail things. But missing a few days back to back, or even missing a whole week, is really a big deal. You're really derailing the whole thing. She's also found that there's a point at which her habit won't get any stronger. There's a kind of a, doesn't matter after that point how much repetition is there, the habit sort of, you know, as far as it's going to go. And the key thing she's found is that situation, as it were, you know, environment and time are two important variables. The more important is environment. So, for example, the getting in the car, reaching for the seatbelt, is going to be a powerful habit regardless of what time of day you get into the car. Habits that are based on time, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon I always do this, are weaker. But if you can get both working together, you tend to optimize the habit formation. So what we've found in practical terms is that students do best in building a meditation habit when they do it first thing in the morning in the same place, okay? And ideally in the same time, but that can be a little bit variable. Now, having stressed that it's important to be kind of a little bit careful about expectations, it is possible to drift the other way. And particularly in building that habit, it's very important, we've found, to bear in mind that human beings are purpose-driven animals. We strongly recommend that people start with a clear intention. Have a reason why you're practicing, and then bring it to mind whenever you sit down to meditate. For example, I wish to gain more perspective around my anger. I wish to be more available to my family. I wish to check my Instagram once a day only. You know, it doesn't really matter what it is, but having a really clear reason why seems to really help. We tend to recommend that people write down their intention. I'm a strong advocate for having a meditation diary, a journaling along with the practice. And then you track it. You establish your intention and then you track it. So the more specific your intention is, the more trackable it becomes. So if you're going to check your Instagram once a day, that's very trackable. Okay, you can keep a note, actually, three times today, four times today. Now, what gets tracked gets transformed. Okay, so the more clear and simple the intention is, even if it's only part of your overall sort of background in wanting to practice, the more narrow and focused your intention can be, typically the more powerful it is. And then once you've kind of really established the intention in one area, you can then expand it or develop it or shift it or change it. But having a clear and powerful intention seems to really help the process work. Now, this is an old Zen saying. Now, it can be bumpy in the early stages, the meditation. It can be very frustrating. There can be emotional sort of stuff releasing. All sorts of things can be going on. But over time, this stuff really works. It's got thousands of years behind it. Sometimes it can work very well indeed. Those intentions we nibble away at become fulfilled. Life can get better. Now, as life does get better, it's possible that we can sort of, as it were, run out of steam on our motivation. We can start to almost bask in our success a little bit, to kind of groove on it, and to lose the kind of the edge in the practice. And that can sort of lead to things beginning to slip, and then we can sort of almost end up back where we started. Now, I think the key here is that while it's very important to learn to be mindful of discomfort, of pain, you know, all the stuff that, you know, we've all got to deal with when it comes along, it's equally important, I think, to be able to be mindful of pleasure. And pleasure doesn't necessarily have to, as it were, put us back to sleep. If we can stay aware and, as it were, maintain an open-handed attitude where we're not holding on and we're not pushing away in the face of pleasure, then actually pleasure tends to bulk larger in our experience. And it can be tremendously helpful over time if we work on that area and start to forge a link between our practice and this non-attached pleasure, if you like, or non-grasping pleasure. What we've seen that tends to do for people is to move this whole game out of the realm of therapy, essentially. We start to do much more than just getting over the bumps and bangs of life. I like the parallels between our work as meditation and mindfulness practitioners and the world of the movement arts. Now, a lot of what's gone on up to this point in our particular world is in many ways a rough parallel to the movement art of physiotherapy, you know, which is a vital and important modality. When you're recovering from an injury, you need to go to a physio. But if the physio does their job right, you're going to get better. You don't want to spend your whole life going to a physio. So how would it be as meditation and mindfulness practitioners, and even more as teachers, if we take our students beyond physio? How about if we start to move in the direction, the inner direction, of teaching our students to dance? Now, the fifth area that seems to sometimes snag people up is assuming it all goes well. Okay, assuming you build your own practice habit, your life begins to transform, you get more and more committed to it, perhaps become so involved that you want to teach, you want to share this wonderful discovery. Now, as we all know, there's a great thirst for this work these days. And from what I've seen, many of the trainings available these days for teachers are really good, really high quality stuff. So if you've got a good training, you've got a commitment there, and also if you've got a little bit of business savvy and organization, you're likely to do very well. After a year or two, perhaps a little bit more, things can really start ramping up. You'll find you get more and more requests to teach. And it's not all that difficult to get to a point where your teaching starts to cut into your own practice time. You can become a victim of your own success. Now, sometimes what starts to happen is it's almost like the joy of the whole thing starts to kind of diminish. It becomes a job in a sense. And particularly, you know, when your own practice starts to suffer, a shine goes off it all, which inevitably is communicated to your students. And so the whole thing starts to potentially spiral a little bit, spiral down. So I strongly always recommend that people put their own practice first and then let the teaching grow out of that. Now, maybe initially that would mean a little bit less teaching, turning down some teaching engagements and so on. But what we find over time is that people's capacity grows. And if the personal practice comes first, then the whole thing retains a kind of an authenticity and a power that will really inspire the those who come to you. So now, there are probably quite a lot of other ways that this wonderful stuff can get snafu'd. These are the five that I've been noticing a lot lately. Now, conversely to all of that, I believe that right now, we're actually probably better placed than almost anybody in the history of the world to get the benefits from a successful and sustained meditation practice. My dream is that we could live in a world where a meditation and mindfulness practice is considered simply a matter of mental fitness. Just, you know, as we take physical fitness to be completely normal and understood and accepted, I think we are potentially in a position that this inner work could take a similar role. And just as we have professional athletes who can take physical development to the skies, potentially we may even find a place in our society for athletes of the mind, if you like. And I feel that as teachers and practitioners, you know, at this time, we're potentially in the vanguard of that kind of new world. So thank you so much for what you're doing. I feel it's an important time. So just some thoughts. Thank you so much.